dobrý.
Amimam
sitaha.
Not considering.
Karmanam.
The path of duty.
Vigataha.
Ruin. Sayasaha.
Sayasaha.
The path of good fortune.
Papa.
Oh, most sinful.
Narad Muni.
Lokayo.
Of the worlds.
Upayo.
What?
Kritaha.
Done.
Translation and purport by His Divine Grace. A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila.
Prajapati Daksha said, my sons were not at all freed from their three debts. Indeed, they did not properly consider their obligations. O Narada Muni, O personality of sinful action, you have obstructed their progress toward good fortune in this world and the next, because they are still indebted to the saintly persons, the demigods, and to their father. Please repeat. Prajapati Daksha said,
My sons
were not at all freed
from their three debts.
Indeed, they did not properly consider
their obligations.
O Narada Muni,
O personality of sinful action,
You have obstructed their progress
toward good fortune
in this world and the next.
Because they are still indebted to the saintly persons,
the demigods,
and their father.
Purport, as soon as a Brahmana takes birth, he assumes three kinds of debts. One, the debts to great saints, then debts to the demigods, and debts to his father. The son of a Brahmana must undergo celibacy, brahmacharya, to clear his debts to the saintly persons. He must perform ritualistic ceremonies to clear the debt, his debts to the demigods. Then he must beget children to become free from his debts to his father. Prajapati Daksha argued that although the renounced order is recommended for liberation, one cannot attain liberation unless one fulfills his obligations to the demigods, to the saints, and to his father. Since Daksha's sons had not liberated themselves from these three debts, how could Narada Muni have led them to the renounced order of life? Apparently, Prajapati Daksha did not know the final decision of the Shastra. Stated in the Srimad Bhagavatam 11.5.41. Devarishi buddhatta ninam pitrinam na kinkaro nayam ni charajam sarvatmana yaha sharanam sharanayam gato mukundam paritriya katam. Everyone is indebted to the demigods, to the living entities in general, to his family, to the Pitas, forefathers, and so on. But if one fully surrenders to Krishna, Mukunda, who can give one liberation, even if one performs no yagyas, one is free from all debts. Even if one does not repay his debts, he is freed from all the debts if he renounces the material world for the sake of the Supreme Personality of Godhead,
whose lotus feet are the shelter of heaven. This is the verdict of Shastra. Therefore, Narada Muni was completely right in instructing the sons of Vrajapati Daksha to renounce the material world immediately and take shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Unfortunately, Prajapati Daksha, the father of the Varyasras and the Savalasyas, did not understand the great service rendered by Narada Muni. Daksha therefore addressed him as Papa, the personality of sinful activities, and Asadu. Heavy words he is using, yeah? An unsaintly person. Since Narada Muni was a great saint and a Vaishnava, he tolerated all such accusations from Prajapati Daksha. He merely performed his duty as a Vaishnava by delivering all the sons of Prajapati Daksha, enabling them to return home, back to Godhead. Om Agyanati Mnumnasya Janam. Snigdha Cheta Supradeta Sopaya Prana Namavakachyutva. Yeah, it's quite intense situation, right? It seems it's a big challenge to practice Krishna consciousness in this world. It will never be easy, either inside also, either outside, and a devotee should take all these challenges. Actually, when we take up Krishna consciousness, we mostly take it up to get free from all troubles, right? And to have a peaceful life. But a bhakta, he will always be peaceful when he practices properly. But he is also ready to take any trouble. Or practicing Krishna consciousness, to continue Krishna consciousness, to protect Krishna consciousness, and to preach Krishna consciousness. So the trouble of a devotee is not a selfish trouble for sense gratification, but there is trouble. Right? All devotees know. And if you go on the street also, not everybody is coming embracing you. Say, hey, give me all the books. Give me. It's a struggle. But the devotee likes to take this struggle. No? It's some taste is there. So. Nectar also. And so there are so many points which has to be considered always in Krishna consciousness, because we have been programmed for so many lifetimes in so many wrong ways. And it takes time and it takes a lot of purification before we get everything right in our heads, in our hearts, in our intelligence, in our mind, in our senses, in our soul. It takes time to situate everything properly. So we can go to some points, which is, one of the things is the debt. It seems we have debt, right? And in the Vedic culture, it is considered, what is this debt? This debt is towards the three debts, Daksha says. You didn't properly
we are young boys, didn't just young boys, they have so much, they got so much from so many instances, and they are still young, they have to repay. They cannot escape their debts, they have to pay for it. They cannot just walk off. And what is these three debts? This is to the demigods, because they supply the air, the water. We have to pay them. But you cannot just take and not reciprocate. That's natural. And then to the saints, who is giving wwisdom. Without wisdom, without strong guidance, you cannot have a proper life. Although they just talk saintly, in the modern society they are useless fellows. Just talking something. But this talk is powerful. Especially when you have good wisdom, which is realized, coming from a personal realization. It affects the heart, it breaks the consciousness, and you save so much trouble by following this saintly advice. And then to the father, because the father, from childhood he supplies all the necessities, he works for it, he gives his energy, his blood for it, so at least clothes and housing and food, and then also mental shelter. And when he is a devotee, he becomes a spiritual master for his sons. But I see the debt today, if you see in modern society, how you can consider debt. They don't consider the demigods. Are they feeling gratefulness towards nature and try to repay nature then, personally? I don't see that also. Do they have saintly persons? Who are considered saintly persons? It's not a saintly person. That also not. And the father, he has some role, but they're also not so much respected nowadays. So what is the debt? It's all transferred to economic debt. But if you lose your gratefulness towards God, then these three debts also disappear almost. But you have debt. One way or other, either in an atheistic society or an atheistic society, you're going to be placed with the responsibility of debt. And that's what's experienced today, enormous debts. All the countries have enormous debts. Because they don't accept Krishna as a supplier, then they have to accept this atheistic beings as suppliers. In the name of bankers, multinationals, and politicians. We take care of you, so you have to pay taxes. So debt is concept is there. Right? And this type of debt is extremely energy sucking. Right? So definitely everybody will always throw on your head your debt for this, you have to take debt for that, right? But then even Pradapati Daksha was a very established leader in the Vedic society, very prominent personality. So that's why he says to the father they are in debt, and I'm their father, and they should come back to produce children. And the population of this world, we have to... Liberation is later on. That is important. We know that's the goal. But now we are here. We cannot just escape. And one of the things is populate. That the souls have to come in human bodies and they have to get opportunity for liberation. If that also is not performed, then you're not doing your duty. So there are so many reasons, so many argumentations. But it is stunning that Prajapati Daksha, although he has also gone through austerity, by austerity you get knowledge. He has studied all the Vedas, but he could not understand what Narada Muni was doing. Not only that, he started accusing him from wrong actions. How you can
A worldly person you can chastise easily for wrong action, but a saintly person, and Dakshan has a lot of understanding of the position of a saintly person, that he can almost, a real saintly person, especially like Narada Muni, how he can do wrong action. Still he was accusing me. That's heavy. So how much in ignorance, even in the heavenly planets, you can be. So Krishna consciousness is such an enormous gift. And whatever struggle we go through in our life, in our spiritual life, that point we always have to realize how extremely fortunate we are that we are allowed to go to this very, very confidential understanding of Krishna consciousness. Yeah. And by coming in touch with Prabhupada. And it's all about Prabhupada, first of all, isn't it? Yeah. If Prabhupada has not put this step to the west and then igniting so many devotees with this exclusive confidential knowledge, then we could never understand, we could not have this discussion. We're so fortunate. I mean, over the years, I just feel more and more fortunate. Not that I feel more and more okay. No, you feel more you start appreciating how valuable things has been given us to us. No? It's amazing. And then those who represent Prabhupada perfectly, we also fully surrender. It's a total, you know, working together. Item, very carefully considering both. Huh? And it's so wonderful. Now here he said, Pradakshmani, Daksha could not understand that when you fully surrender to the Supreme Lord, really, you give all your life, practically, in the service to Krishna, either as a brahmachari or as a gyanista. Your aim is, your decision is total surrender to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Then there is no more debt. That's good, huh? So why is that? How can you just say that? Huh? Yeah. Because there is no more sacrifice than the full dedication to the Supreme Lord. Right? You are not only sacrificing your senses, or on the process of sweating to sacrifice your senses. Right? You are not only sacrificing your senses, you are trying to sacrifice your mind by always bringing to the holy name, to the services, to the devotees, to the scripture. That's a sacrifice. This mind has to go to these items and nowhere else. And even when you walk outside, you always, with your mind, try to connect to Krishna, whatever you see, whatever you go through. And that, otherwise you have to a person who is not a devotee, how he's paying his debt? By working for the boss, he's putting his senses there, he's putting his mind, what he's telling what to do, or to the school, you go to the syllabus, that's a sacrifice. So how it, a devotee can never be blamed because he's doing the same principle to the perfect personality. So he's paying debt, absolutely, like mad. But nobody pays the debt of false ego. And that is the extra debt. So the devotees are the best tax payers. The devotees are the best tax payers. Because they are working on that false ego which we never want to give up on us. You can control senses, that can be bad. Mind, intelligence, intellectual, going through things, that's nice. But sacrificing the false ego, that's sweating. Yeah. But that is a devotee ready to do, just for the pleasure of Krishna. So automatically everything is paid. By as long as you go through the process. If you stop the process, then all the debt come back. Then you will feel it, right? But as you go through the process, all the debt is free. But Pradhat Ridaksha, he is not from Kali Yuga. When he would be from Kali Yuga, we could understand that he started arguing and blaspheming. All our useless fellow devotees. Who cares for a devotee in this modern society? Sometimes a lonely life. Because that I want to read something from an article of Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati. So intensely it is being tried to root it out. But devotees are mortal. They keep pushing Krishna consciousness into the society. Right? That's why devotees should develop very genuine relationship between themselves, because they're only few. Devotees are only few. And this is the only protection for a human society. Devotees in the society, devotees in the city, is the only protection. It's very rare. So we have to very deeply consider the association of other devotees, like anything. But the problem is we are coming out of a society which is extremely impersonal. Nirvises, sunyavadi paschatam. That's why Prabhupada came to the West. So these fellows in the West, they are too proud. They have technology, but they don't know nothing, peanuts, about living together properly. Because they are so, we have been a tradition of nirvises, sunyavadi. See each other as mechanical robots, behaviorism. You should do like this. It's much more. Dealing with a person is much more than just putting some rules and regulations. You have to behave like this, you have to talk like this, you have to dress like this, you have to think like this. Don't think like this, you have to think like this. Otherwise, apparat. That's like treating each other like a machine. Not good. You have to see the person and how he is endeavoring to be Krishna conscious, and that kind. But you can only do that if the love has a little bit starts sprouting. Over the time you practice, there is a new experience in the heart, an affection you never have experienced before. A deep affection which is so genuine for the other jiva, for the other soul. Because as you start seeing Krishna, you start seeing the soul. As you don't see Krishna, you cannot see the soul. You see something moving before you, something talking, somebody talking, but you cannot relate. That is the difference between, what is the difference between Kanishtha Adhikari, Madhyama Adhikari, Uttama Adhikari? A Kanishtha Adhikari, he theoretically sees Krishna. Not much real. And he cannot understand the devotees. There are some people also chanting like me, but that's all. He's not giving his heart to them. But a Madhyam, he can deal with the devotees. And as you deal with the devotees, the community life of devotees keep flourishing. I'm always surprised why. I'm surprised the difference in how they practice Krishna in the East and how they practice Krishna consciousness in the West. Why in the West we have only small units, and why in India the units are so big of devotees? There are so many devotees in India, and always here a few. Why is that? There's a reason for it. Because when Prabhupada left India, there were no devotees in India. And when he came to West, he made it here. But here we could not grow much. But in India we grow like anything. Why? The difference is they were more, India more expert how to deal with devotees. So then they don't go away. Why so many joining and after some time they go away? After 3, 4, 5 years, 6 years, 7 years. Then they say, yeah, it's all the same, you know. Chanting, chanting, doing the same. Because there is no taste in the association of devotees.
very important, very essential.
So then another very important point is nice. So this Krishna consciousness is also totally based on the practice of brahmacharya. Brahmacharya cannot be glorified enough. Because it is the pillar of Vedic civilization, it is the pillar of a spiritual life, the pillar of society, it is the power of a harmonious society. It all comes from brahmacharya. And Prabhupada Rai said here, how the son of a brahmana must undergo celibacy, brahmacharya, to clear his debt to the saintly persons. That is interesting. How you repay a debt as a devotee, as a brahmana? By practicing brahmacharya. That's interesting, man. If you go to the banks and you talk this kind of debts to pay. But I think this is the way how we come out of the crisis of today. The people have to start understanding the brilliancy of Krishna consciousness through the importance of brahmacharya. So brahmacharya in this book, this is a very nice book, and we should go to that tomorrow also. This is Brahmacharya in Krishna Consciousness, Bhakti Kasmarak. In Tirupati, our temple president, always every day 10 minutes before the Bhagavatam class, we read from this book also. And it's very inspiring to hear. We can just read a few points on this. Karmis work very hard simply to enjoy sex. Modern human society has improved the materialistic way of life simply by inducing unrestricted sex life in many different ways. This is most prominently visible in the Western world. A systematic family life as enjoined in the Vedas is better than an irresponsible sinful life. If your husband and wife combine together in Krishna consciousness and live together peacefully, that is very nice. However, if a husband becomes too much attracted by his wife, forgets his duty in life, the implications of materialistic life will again resume. Srila Rupa Goswami has therefore recommended anashaktasya visayam. Without being attached by sex, the husband and wife may live together for the advancement of spiritual life. The husband should engage in devotional service and the wife should be faithful, religious according to the Vedic injunctions. Such a combination is very good. However, if the husband becomes too much attached to the wife due to the sex, the position becomes very dangerous. Women in general are very, very much sexually inclined. Indeed, it is said that a woman's sex desire is 9 times stronger than a man's. It is therefore a man's duty to keep a woman under his control by satisfying her, giving her ornaments, nice food and clothes, and engaging her in religious activities. Of course, a woman should have a few children and in this way not be disturbed to the man. Unfortunately, if the man becomes attracted to the woman simply for sexual enjoyment, then family life becomes abominable. So, actually, it said when you stay brahmachari, you save so much trouble, right? It says when you stay your whole life brahmachari, you're how much percent liberated? 80%?
Well, Prabhupada said, since you get married, you have 75%.